يا يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة وآتيناه الحكم صبيا
إذ قال الله يا عيسى إني متوفيك ورافعك إلي
محمد رسول الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. الله سبحانه وتعالى informs us in the Quran that the human beings, and he's the one that created the human beings, they have weaknesses, they have deficiencies. And it's the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with these weaknesses and deficiencies, there is a wisdom behind it. He's the Most High. If He wills subhanahu wa ta'ala, He would have created us in such a perfect way. But we are created weak. We have our weaknesses. Being humans, it means certain things. And this is something that is mentioned in the Quran. And part of that is that for human beings, they have the ability to overcome their weaknesses. We have the means to overcome, to overpower our own weaknesses, our own selves, to perfect ourselves in a way that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the struggle that a human being should live. And that's why as human beings, when someone just surrender himself to his own desire or to his own weakness, you would find the clear examples of this. People, those who spread corruption on the face of earth, those who don't want to think, those who want to follow their desires, they become lazy, they would rather steal than to put the effort to work and to earn. All kinds of evil examples as a result of surrendering oneself to our own weaknesses. But the believers are different. The believers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He guided them. They know that they have a purpose in this life, and part of which is to overcome their enemies. There is the shaitan, the devil, that is whispering to the human beings to work on their weaknesses rather than to overcome it. There's our own self, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us, whether it's physical weaknesses or non-physical weaknesses, as we would see inshallah ta'ala in the verses of the Quran. So the point here is for those who do not know themselves as human beings, that's a huge problem. For many people, they do not know what a human being means, what it takes to be a human being, whether it's in the good sense or the weaknesses. So they think that human beings has to be perfect, and that's why they are so critical to others. They don't accept any apology from anyone. Why? Because they want human beings to treat them in a perfect way and overlooking the fact that they are weak and they have weaknesses, and that's why there's repentance and forgiveness and so on. And on the other hand, when a person doesn't see himself and doesn't know the means to overcome these weaknesses, and all of that is explained clearly in the book of Allah, the Quran. We need to get and to seek the guidance from the book of Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one that created us and created us in such a way that we would find the cure to our weaknesses in the book of Allah, in the Quran, and in the way of the Prophet ﷺ. We are in Surah Hud, and Surah Hud calls us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, to seek forgiveness from Allah, and to repent to Allah. And it shows also some of the things are that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in the human beings and how to overcome this, as we would see in these set of verses inshallah ta'ala in Surah Hud, verses number 9 to verse number 12. From 9 to 12, this is what we're going through inshallah ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the ability to understand and to make us among those who know, and then they act according to the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them. So let's start with verse number 9. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Hud, verse number 9, وَلَئِنْ أَذَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِنَّا رَحْمَةً ثُمَّ نَزَعْنَاهَا مِنْهُ إِنَّهُ لَيَأُوسٌ كَفُورٌ. Which means, and if we give man a taste of mercy from us, and then we withdraw it from him, indeed he is despairing and ungrateful. So this is part of the verse, or as we see this verse and the one next, it shows that how human beings, how they are as being human beings. it is not just referring to the evil ones or to the disbelievers. This is how the human beings would be unless they do something. And that exception is going to be mentioned after the second verse. So be patient, inshallah ta'ala, and reflect upon this, because this is very important, so that we don't think of ourselves, no, that's not me, that's other human beings. No, this is our own selves. This is how we are, unless we do something about it and about this weakness. So, وَلَئِنْ أَذَقْنَا الْإِنسَانِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if we أَذَقْنَا, if we make taste, أَذَقْنَا is the meaning of tasting something, and the noon alif at the end is with refers to we, the royal we, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also the angels, those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send them to give or to take, you know, with regards to the qadr of Allah. So, وَلَئِنْ أَذَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ, الْإِنسَانَ are the human beings. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the human being taste minna, from us, from Allah, and every word has its significance. That means whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever the human beings they go through, it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the human being taste minna, from us, rahmah. Rahmah means mercy. So if the human being tastes the mercy from Allah, what is the mercy from Allah? Physical things in this life that people can taste, which is basically the food. We taste the food, the things that we drink, the thing that sustains our life, the air that we breathe, goodness in this life, wealth, health, strength in general, offsprings, the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala adorned this life with. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provide the human being with some of the mercy of Allah, and that shows that anything that is pleasant for us in this life, it's a mercy from Allah. Mercy from Allah as a test, because this is what the previous verses talked about. How are you going to deal with these trials and tests from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This mercy from Allah is given to the human being for a reason. And we will see the reason as it's mentioned afterwards. So it's given for a reason by the wisdom of Allah. So, but now let's focus on how the human beings are, how we are. So if the human beings is given a mercy from Allah with all what that means, and it's mentioned as nakira, that means anything, whether it's small or big, or physical matters, non-physical matters, anything that is of goodness, mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ثُمَّ نَزَعْنَاهَا مِنْهَا, then we take it away from him, then we withdraw it from him. And the naz' is when you take your clothes off. You know, one of the meanings of it is when someone has a garment, then he takes it off, that means it's completely off the person, and it has that meaning that it's an immediate one, or basically something that a person had and now it's gone, it does not exist anymore. Say for example, health. He was healthy and now he's not healthy. He was rich and now he's poor. He had something and it's taken away from him. Whether it's something physical or something that is non-physical. Relationships, a loved one, one's eyes, one's hearing, whatever there is. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the human being first taste. And again, the significance of أَذَقْنَا, that the human being get to taste something. Not that he heard about it or from a distance. No, he tasted that mercy of Allah. He tasted that goodness or that pleasure that he had in this life, then it's withdrawn away from him, taken away from him completely. He does not have it anymore. ثُمَّ نَزَعْنَاهُ, who's the one that provided it for him? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what minna means, from us. And who's the one that took it away from him? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ثُمَّ نَزَعْنَاهَا, then we took it or withdraw it away from him. What happened to that human being? إِنَّهُ لَيَأُوسٌ كَفُورٌ, indeed he is human being, as the human race. He is Ya'us and Kafur. He's despairing and ungrateful. Ya'us, someone that is despairing from the mercy of Allah, that no goodness will happen to him. This is how the human being would feel. That means he would feel that he's ruined. He's gone. He's never going to make it again. He despairs from the mercy of Allah. If he sees things, he sees his own power only and his own will. If he lost something that he tasted the goodness of it, now he refers to himself only, and when he sees himself, he sees himself weak. So he'd say, how can I would ever taste that again? Or if he believes in himself, as some people say, that means he would say, I have to take these means and to do this to gain again what I've lost and things of that nature. But he's still being Ya'us. He's been despairing still from the mercy of Allah. That he's not seeing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that provided it for him, and he's the one that took it away from him. So that human being, he's only seeing himself. So that means he's going to be always in that state of being in disparity. He does not see the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala coming back to him after it's been taken away from him. So this is with regards to the goodness that it might happen again. Kafur means ungrateful. He's ungrateful to Allah that when he had the favors of Allah, he was not grateful to Allah. And he still, when something is taken away from him, he's still ungrateful for the things that he still have. The fact that he's still alive to worship Allah. The fact that he's still able to breathe, for example. And he lost one thing and he still have something else. He's poor. He tested by a relationship that is causing him all kinds of trouble. But he has other favors of Allah. So he becomes ungrateful because of one thing that is disturbing him. And we see that clearly in our life. So someone has all kinds of favors of Allah. But one thing that happens to him that he doesn't like. He looks and he feels miserable. And as if he does have nothing whatsoever. So this is how human beings are. This is how human beings are, especially if they are given, then it's taken away from them. The verse is talking about a specific example. Because people, maybe some of them afterwards, they might overcome these bad feelings. But someone is given something of fortune, something of goodness, then it's taken away from him, he would feel that way, being in despair and also being ungrateful. So this is condemned as it's clearly, but this is how human beings are. More, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the next verse. وَلَئِنْ أَذَقْنَاهُ نَعْمَاءَ بَعْدَ ضَرَّاءَ مَسَّتْهُ لَيَقُولَنَّ ذَهَبَ السَّيِّئَاتُ عَنِّي إِنَّهُ لَفَرِحٌ فَخُورٌ. But if we give him a taste of favor after hardship has touched him, he will surely say, bad times have left me. Indeed, he is exultant and boastful. Which means the opposite. If he is adhaqnahu again, if we make him taste, na'ma, favor. Favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ba'da darra, after hardship. So the opposite of the previous verse. So this is someone that has been facing hardship and then ease comes. And a favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether it's poverty, he becomes rich. Whether it's sickness, he becomes healthy. You know, all kinds of things. What happened to him? Masatu, touched him. لا يقولن, he would say then, ذهب السيئات عني. He would say, I've never seen any bad times before. Bad times have left me. It's not going to happen. It's not going to return again. And this is how, again, arrogant or forgetful or ignorant the human beings can be. So this might sound as something pleasant to some other human beings because he's happy. He would say, this is never going to happen to me again. So that means he's happy. He's looking into things in a positive way. But in reality, he's not. Because he's not witnessing the power of Allah. The favors of Allah, the mercies of Allah, the hardship, the difficulties is not affecting his heart and his actions to fulfill the objectives of his life. And this is something that we would see the exception of that for the believers. So when someone we see happy and content, but he's not obedient to Allah. He's not obedient to Allah. He's not fulfilling the purpose of his life. Is that person in good state? The answer is no. He still have disparities, ungrateful. He is someone, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in this verse, إِنَّهُ لَفَرِحٌ فَخُورٌ. He is farih. That means he is happy, not really happy, but rather he is in such a way of making himself in some level of enjoyment that is not real. And the one to be exalting the matters of goodness that he has been ungrateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not those who have that state of farah, is the farah of being ungrateful, is the farah or the enjoyment that a person would have referring to himself only, sinful enjoyment. When a person sin as a result of being happy. And many sins are committed when people are happy. When people feel good, many of them, they become forgetful of the favors of Allah. They become forgetful of what's coming ahead of them. And they start committing sins. And that's why many sins are done in that state of enjoyment or in the state of being having means in this life. You know, people, you would see how people, they party and they follow their desires and they even abuse others because they feel that they are in a good way or in a good state and things like this. Fakhur, someone that is boasting over his own self. He thinks he has that pride against others, looking down at others. He's better than others. He is in a good state because he is better than others. Others are inferior to him. Whether it's because of the color of their skin or because of his authority versus those who have no authorities or whatever there is. And this is something that we should contemplate over the things that human beings are upon in this life. We all see things. We all understand how human beings, they can really have good things and bad things in them. So these are two qualities, and before that, two other qualities that are condemned in these verses, that human beings, they get and they fall into these feelings and these actions and these qualities if they are not upon what's mentioned in the next verse. So as humans, human being, they have these things. They're ungrateful. They are in disparity if a situation happens to them. They are in a state of enjoyment in a sinful way. They're boasting and they're having a pride that is an evil way if another situation happens to them, as it's mentioned in the details, as it's mentioned in these verses. But what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants then from the people, if they believe, this is something that is mentioned in the next verse. So let's inshallah ta'ala get to that, but after the break. So we'll see you soon, inshallah.
محمد رسول الله محمد رسول الله
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Welcome back. The Quran, the words of Allah, amazing. It's how it exposes us as human beings. It's very amazing that we as human beings, no matter how smart a human being is, but we really don't know ourselves in the right way, in the most precise way. And that's why many of us, if we don't look into the book of Allah, we are ignorant about even our own selves. Many people, they don't see how harmful they are to others because there's something that has been concealing to them. They don't see themselves when it comes to their bad traits and behaviors and things like this. They think that they are great. They don't have to work on themselves whatsoever. And that's why when we recite the Quran exposes what's in the nature of the human beings, that if a person is not working to overcome these weaknesses, he is upon it. So he does not need to defend himself. The question is, did you work on yourself to overcome these weaknesses? If the answer is no, and if working on oneself, meaning following what's in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, not according to what we desire. So if a person doesn't do that, then he can defend himself for the rest of his life. It doesn't make a difference. It does not change the fact that he has these ignorant and evil traits, because this is present in the human beings. Whether they have matters of ease and that change to hardship, they, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, they become despairing and ungrateful. These are two evil characteristics. Or the other hand, if someone is given goodness and favor from Allah after hardship, right? A person would see himself boasting of his own self, having the sinful enjoyment, forgetting about the favors of Allah, and it's all evil attributes and characteristics. Who will be saved from this? Who are the ones that would overcome their weaknesses? This is mentioned in the next verse, verse number 11. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ صَبَرُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَأَجْرٌ كَبِيرٌ. Except for those who are patient and do righteous deeds, those will have forgiveness and great reward. Subhanallah, it's very easy, it's very clear, and it needs the effort, and it needs the work to be done for the person to be among the exception. And you see how the verse starts with إِلَّا الَّذِينَ صَبْرُ, except those. That means the norm is what? Is what's mentioned in the previous verses. These two previous verses need to be looked at and to be reflected upon. This is who you are as a human being. Except, unless you do something about yourself, you'll be as evil as mentioned in the previous two verses. So إِلَّا الَّذِينَ صَبْرُ, except for those who are patient. As-sabr is mentioned first. Those who are patient. Patient in what? Patient in doing what? Patient with their own selves. Patient, and the meanings of patience is as they define patience, is habsun nafs, when you make yourself hostage, meaning that you prevent yourself from acting according to its norm for something good or a better thing that is beyond yourself. Meaning, as we mentioned before, as we heard before, something good happens to the person after hardship or vice versa. So as human beings, he would tend to be ignorant, he would tend to be in disparity, he would tend to be ungrateful and so on. But if a person has patience, so he withhold himself by seeking rewards from Allah, by seeing the end of these things, by understanding that this is part of the test of Allah, as it's mentioned in verse number 7, that you have been tested. If you are at times of ease, if you're sitting and eating and breathing and all kinds of good things, you are being tested by Allah. So you seek rewards from Allah. You are patient with the fact that you are at times of ease, so that you don't let yourself be led astray by living a sinful enjoyment. But rather, make this time of ease, being patient with the orders of Allah, so continue to be obedient to Allah. Be away from following your sinful desires. Follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ. Be grateful to Allah. We need to have patience to be grateful. Because when a person tends to be at ease, he tends to be forgetful. So we need to think of how to be grateful. The heart needs to be grateful to Allah. And as we mentioned before, the ways of the Quran that is mentioned here, is that one of the ways is to train your heart. We need to train ourselves by thinking, what if this favor of Allah, if I don't have it, my life will be, I don't like for that to happen, so I need to be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now. And if it happens, he's patient still. So, but here, he's patient with at all levels that a person, whether at times of difficulties or times of ease. Some of the ulama, they mentioned in the tafsir of the verse as comparing it to the previous verses. So, sabaru here, patience refers to the difficulties that are mentioned in the verses. So if the mercy is taken away, which is a matter of hardship, or ad-darra that is mentioned in the previous verse, which is hardship. So therefore, if they are patient in that state of difficulties, then they are the exception. That means they are patiently seeking rewards from Allah. They know that everything is from Allah, so they seek rewards from Allah. And the reward of such people are mentioned still in the verse. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, and they did righteous good deeds. So some said or referred to this in the tafsir with regards to those who are at times of ease, as mentioned in the previous verses. So those who are at times of ease, or they receive mercy from Allah, they do righteous good deeds. This is also the sign of them being grateful to Allah. And doing the righteous good deeds also when they are at times of difficulties. So they still establish the salah. Their hearts are in state of patience. They fear Allah, they hope for the rewards from Allah, they don't think bad about Allah. And all of these are good deeds. You know, having husn al-dhann billah, to think good about Allah when a person is in difficult times, that everything is from Allah and the ease will come, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran. So deeds done by the heart, if we talk about these deeds at times of ease and at times of difficulties, there are so many. And deeds done by the tongue in speech, not to complain too much, not to say things that is sinful, but rather to be grateful to Allah and to say words of comfort and words of goodness and to be busy with the worship of Allah and physical means also. And that does not contradict the fact that the human beings will take the means to push away the harm and to keep the goodness and to establish what is good. But they need to be patient with themselves. They need to be patient with the orders of Allah, times of ease or times of difficulties, and to do righteous good deeds. So these two things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, these are the two means to overcome the weaknesses that is mentioned in the previous verses. As-sabr wal-amal as-salih. Patience and righteous good deeds. So patience, as we said, to be obedient, to be patient in the obedience of Allah. Even if you don't desire that, be patient with yourself. Patience have the essence of bitterness. It's not the enjoyment of this life to be patient, right? Nobody likes patience in the essence of it, right? But people like to be patient, right, for something good that comes afterwards. So when they're patient, patiently waiting for a good food that is being cooked, they don't mind being patient. Why? Because this is how they're going to eat a good meal, right? But if they want to eat something that is not as good, they can be in haste and just take it, eat it raw, for example, right? So people, as human beings, we understand how to be patient. Or to go to work and to be patient because of the paycheck at the end of the week or the end of the month. So when people, they understand what patience lead to, the same thing with matters of the deen, with matters of the purpose of our life. So those who are patient in matters of obedience to Allah, patiently away from sins, when their nafs, when their desire is pulling them towards committing an act that is sinful, they're patiently staying away from it. And that might need struggle and something that a person doesn't like as far as his feelings are concerned, but he's patiently doing that for the sake of Allah and being patient with the qadr of Allah, the decree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed upon him that he's in state of hardship or a state of ease or whatever. And the second thing is وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, and did righteous good deeds. These righteous good deeds also are not left for our own desires and our own opinions. This is something that is mentioned clearly in the Book of Allah and in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. For the deeds to be righteous, it has to be sincerely for the sake of Allah, has to be according to the way of the Prophet ﷺ. You might choose for yourself, if it's a desirable thing, that, okay, one of the good deeds that I like to do is to smile to people, for example. That's fine, it's a charity, as the Prophet ﷺ said. But if it's time for the salah comes, then you have to establish the salah. It is not sufficient to say, well, I'm kind to people, and that's good enough for me to be a righteous person or a good person. This is in the relationship with people. Yes, people will trust you. You're honest, you're truthful in your tijara, in your trade, in your work. This is good, mashallah. This is part of the religion. But when the time for Salatul Dhuhr comes, you're a slave of Allah. Those who do righteous good deeds, they are patient to establish the salah at the time of the salah. When it's a person is presented with something haram, whether it's at work or at a place, and people are gathered on a sin to be committed, drinking or partying in a sinful way or backbiting, whatever there is, he has to be patient and to be away from the sins. People might not like him as a result of this. He might feel like he's being an outcast, or they would ridicule him. Be patient. Be patient with people. Be patient when people, they ridicule you, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the previous verses. They won't leave you alone. Human beings, they don't leave each other alone, right? They would ridicule whoever they like to ridicule. They might take means of trying to harm that person or things of that nature. Human beings, the believers, if they do not endure patience, they will compromise their religion. So patience is such an essential one. Without it, there's no religion is to be established in the life of the people. Nobody liked to be ridiculed. Nobody liked to be labelized by something or labeled by something that is negative. Nobody likes this, you know. But when it comes to your action, right? Sometimes people are labeled something when they have no means in it whatsoever, because of the color of their skin or because of their nationalities or their accent or things of that nature that they don't have a say in. Right? But so you can imagine also when a person chooses to be upon something and he faces all kinds of difficulties from people. When a person chooses to be a believer, chooses to be a righteous person, he needs to be patient with what comes as a result of this. So sabr, patience, is the best time of one's life is to be patient. As Umar radiallahu anhu, he said clearly, وَجَدْنَا خَيْرُ أَيَّامِنَا فِي الصَّبْرِ. We found the best of our days and our lives in patience. So this is the life of the believers, by enduring patience to be obedient to Allah, to be away from sins with the qadr of Allah, and they do righteous good deeds. What is the reward of these people when they know that they have to be like this, otherwise they will be among those who are condemned in the Quran? أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَأَجْرٌ كَبِيرٌ. These are the people that they would have maghfirah, forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a great reward. The verse did not mention something of a reward in this life. It's mentioned in other parts of the Quran. But those who are patient, they don't seek rewards in this life. Those who are patient with their own selves, whether they face difficulties or hardship or goodness, and they do righteous good deeds, they seek in rewards from Allah in the hereafter. So they will get what they are seeking. They seek forgiveness from Allah, so they'll get what they're seeking. وَأَجْرٌ كَبِيرٌ, and a great reward. A great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be given for them. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised something, the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the truth. So this is the means to be forgiven. It is not just that a person say, oh Allah, forgive me, but we need to be patient. We need to do righteous good deeds knowingly that we will face these types of changings in our life. Life does not stay on the same way. This is how life is. One day a person would feel happy, another day he feels sad. In the same day even, a person passes an exam and another time he fails. Or relationships sometimes is good, sometimes a person doesn't get what he expects from others. We have our own expectations, and no human being would like to expect the bad, but everybody have expectations of all kinds of goodness. But the reality of life is not like this. The good expectation should be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We always think good about Allah. But when it comes to this life, we know that we will face all kinds of things in it. And that's why we have to put ourselves in that state of being patient. And definitely make dua to Allah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make life good for us, to give us strength in all things, physical matters, non-physical matters. That's why the dua, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Oh Allah, give us the goodness in this life and the goodness in the hereafter, and shield us from the hellfire. So everybody, and one of the dua of the Prophet ﷺ, to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for al-afiyya. So, but then to always having the heart attached to the hereafter. What is the concern of those who are patient and they do righteous good deeds? If they're given a choice, whether to have the sins, all the sins forgiven, or something else, forgiveness of the sins. Because this is the ultimate and the everlasting goodness. If a person's sins are forgiven, that means he will enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The moment of death, what makes the moment of death a fearful one? Because a person doesn't know what's going to happen afterwards. He's going to be punished, or he's going to receive the mercy of Allah and the sins are forgiven. If a believer get to know that at the moment of death, his sins will be forgiven and he will be given the rewards from Allah and the mercy from Allah, he doesn't want to come back anymore to this world. You know, the hereafter is better for the believers in this life that we cling to it so much, if a person is forgiven, if a person is, reach the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is basically what the verse are saying here. This is basically the means to achieve this. Patience and righteous good deeds, the people will have the forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَجْرٌ كَبِيرٌ. Not just forgiveness and that's it, but a great rewards from Allah, all kinds of pleasurable things, far more than this world and whatever it contains. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the reality of it. But we'll continue inshallah ta'ala with more after the break, so stay with us inshallah.
Muhammadur Rasulullah. Muhammadur Rasulullah.
Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu rasulullah wa ba'd. As we heard, the verse is talking about the exception and how to override or to overpower and overcome our weaknesses by patience and righteous good deeds. And the reward of such people are the forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the great rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to the believers, nothing even close to such a reward. And that's why they put the effort and they have the hearts attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the things that would benefit them in the hereafter. After that, the next verse, verse number 12, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam with all of what's mentioned before, saying to the Prophet and to the Ummah of the Prophet, فَلَعَلَّكَ تَارِكُمْ بَعْضَ مَا يُوحَى إِلَيْكَ وَضَائِقٌ بِهِ صَدْرُكَ أَنْ يَقُولُوا لَوْلَا أُنْزِلَ عَلَيْهِ كَنْزٌ أَوْ جَاءَ مَعَهُ مَلَكٌ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ نَذِيرٌ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَكِيلٌ. Which means, then would you possibly leave out some of what is revealed to you, or is your breast constrained by it? Because they say, why has there not been sent down to him a treasure or come with him an angel? But you are only a warner, and Allah is disposer of all things. فَلَعَلَّكَ تَارِكُمْ بَعْضَ مَا يُوحَى إِلَيْكَ. The Prophet ﷺ never left anything of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to him, perfectly following the message and the revelation from Allah, conveying it perfectly and applying it perfectly in his life alayhi salatu wasalam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he knows his Prophet and he knows that it bothers him so much alayhi salatu wasalam that people are opposing the truth out of the goodness in his heart towards the people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that would you leave some of what Allah revealed to you because of what you feel inside of that tightness in your heart because of what people are doing? The believers, the Prophet ﷺ, and he is the head of all of the believers, When he's calling people to their own salvation, he does not want anything from them. He doesn't want any money from them, does not want for them to give him any status or anything. He wants what is good for them. So when they oppose the truth with arrogance, with ridiculing, with causing, trying to cause harm to the Prophet ﷺ, that used to cause so much burden for the Prophet ﷺ and feelings that is mentioned throughout the Quran. And it's the same thing for anyone that is upon the truth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the Prophet ﷺ and the followers of the Prophet ﷺ and the righteous ones, that would you then compromise any of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to you? Because what makes the disbelievers not happy with you, angry with you, they try to harm you, they ridicule you, is because of the content of the revelation that is sent to you. Because they want to follow their desires. So you tell them to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and to leave these partners that they associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with, they would ridicule you. They won't like you. So would you compromise? Would you approve in belief what they have? Because otherwise they'll be mad at you. If you say that there is something called disbelief and faith or belief, there is kufr and iman, there is, you know, people that are disbelievers and believers, they won't like you. They will rage a war against you unless you say everybody's good. Whatever people believe is absolutely fine. Everybody, you know, is in a good state, and everybody in the hereafter would receive whatever they desire. This is denying the truth that is mentioned in the Quran. So would you then compromise or leave some of the things that Allah revealed to you, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet ﷺ to say, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَأَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ, and so on, verses in the Quran. To leave some of the basic beliefs in the deen of Allah, that this religion is the religion of the haqq, the truth, and other than the religion of Islam, is falsehood. In a good way, yes, without causing any physical harm to anyone, yes, definitely, sure. But there is something called haqq, truth, and something called falsehood. And the people of the truth, they, when they call the people of falsehood to the truth, they do that with goodness, with kindness, and so on. But there's something called right and wrong, and so on. And in the details of this, you know, would you compromise the deen of Allah and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to you? Because they, if they are, for example, they people that drink intoxicants, they won't like you if you tell them, you know, fear Allah, stay away from this, this is harmful for you, this is haram. They won't like you. Would you compromise your religion then? If they won't like you, if you say that riba is haram, usury is haram, and all other money is investing in riba and usury, they won't like you. They think that you're extreme or whatever there is. Would you then leave some of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to you? And so on and so forth. Such a powerful meaning in this verse, that when we, you know, make it clearly also with the previous one, be patient with the orders of Allah. We're not talking about matters that have differences of opinions or things of that nature. Things that are well established in the deen of Islam. Halal and haram, what's permissible, what's not permissible, things of that nature. So would you then leave some of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to you because you have that tightness inside of yourself when they ridicule you, when they don't like you, right? Seeking the pleasure of the human beings is not in the objectives of the believers. The believers, they seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. But they are kind to everyone. Right? If people are pleased, mashallah, this is good. But if they're not pleased because you are pleasing to Allah, you're doing the things that pleases Allah, then this is not something that you choose, but rather this is what you are. You are a slave to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, and يَقُولُ لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ كَنْزٌ, that they would say, why there's no treasure is coming down on him? Or أَوْ جَاءَ مَعْهُ مَلَكٌ, then an angel, why doesn't an angel come with him? Like, this is their evil suggestions, not because they want to believe, but they're saying that out of arrogance. So the Prophet ﷺ, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to him, this would cause you to be to leave some of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to you, and the Prophet ﷺ would never do such a thing. But this is a verse that is revealed to the Prophet ﷺ to give comfort to the Prophet ﷺ, right? This is to comfort the Prophet ﷺ in facing the disbelievers. Not that the Prophet ﷺ would think about leaving some of what Allah revealed to him, but rather this is as the entire surah giving comfort to the Prophet ﷺ, as also will be mentioned towards the end of the surah. So because they will say these types of things for you, they will suggest all these types of evil things for you. So what should you then do? And then in this situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to him, إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ نَذِيرٌ, you are nothing but a warner. You're just warning them. You're not, this is not that you in your capacity or in your power to change anything in the revelation from Allah. This is to the Prophet ﷺ. So you can imagine what is it then to those who are less than the Prophet ﷺ. When people in the context of dealing with disbelievers, whether it's inviting them, whether it's dealing with them, this is not, you don't have ownership over that religion to change in it the way that you like. When you compromise the orders of Allah, thinking that this is a way to attract them, this is the way for them to like the religion of Islam. إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ نَذِيرٌ. You are a warner, you're nothing but a warner. You convey the message. And if you are upon what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you, right, you just convey the message and you are a warner. You don't change anything, you don't take things, you don't hide things. That's why everything in the deen of Islam is wide open. Everything, anybody that wants to know anything, that they can come and ask and they would know. And this is the orders of Allah. إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ نَذِيرٌ. So this is an important call for those who compromise their religion, thinking that this is the way to attract others to the deen of Islam. You know, to approve what people are upon in matters of ignorance and jahiliyyah, so that they don't run away from the deen of Islam. And this actually, this concept can be on many different levels. As some people, for example, would say, well, if people are upon sin, let them be on the sin so that we can save them from a bigger sin. This is a different situation, but to approve and to change in the religion, and for a person himself to commit a sin, thinking that this is a way to save people from harm, or those who are callers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they start acting in a way, imitating the disbelievers in the way they look, in their hairstyles, or things of that nature, or the way they act, right? Imitating the ways of the disbelievers, thinking that this is the way to attract people to the deen of Islam. You are a warner. You are nothing but a warner. Yes, you use wisdom and things of that nature, and that's why we're asking the people of knowledge, إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ نَذِيرٌ. But imitating the ways of the disbelievers would not going to grant you anything. وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَكِيلٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the disposer of all things, all of the affairs of the people. So leave the matter to Allah. It requires knowledge, it requires wisdom, it requires forbearance and humbleness and goodness. And this is all the way of the Prophet ﷺ. We have in the Prophet ﷺ the best example. Never the Prophet ﷺ compromised anything of the religion of Islam. Never he would distort the message of the religion of Islam or hide anything from it. He understood the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very clearly. And even though the Prophet ﷺ was the most humble of all of the human beings, he was the most merciful among all of the human beings, the most that had the concern towards all human beings, and the most kind to others, and the most lenient, and so on and so forth, still he had enemies, alayhi salatu wasalam. He still had people to ridicule him and to say all kinds of evil things about him. So if this is to the Prophet ﷺ, how would it be then to those who are less than the Prophet ﷺ? So it does not make a person a good person if people are pleased with him. What makes a person a good person, as we heard in the verse, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ صَبَرُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Those who are patient and they do righteous good deeds according to the way of the Prophet ﷺ. And for those who are inviting others to Allah, they warn and they give glad tidings according to the way of the Prophet ﷺ. So the way that, or the practical part of these verses is, we need to learn the deen of Islam. We need to learn the way of the Prophet ﷺ so that we don't take just general concepts like this and then we make it part of our actions based on our personality. So if someone has bad manners, he would continue, he would think that he's patiently following the deen of Allah with his bad manners. It doesn't work this way. Someone that gets angry quickly, you know, and this is something that is in him. He did not overcome this weakness in him, and he has other good things in his life, and people would think that this is the religion of Islam. This is not the religion of Islam. But rather, we need to follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ and do the best we can and seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to understand that we are nothing but obedient slaves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the most important concern in the life of the believers is to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And if a person doing what is pleasing to Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make people pleased with him, those of goodness. But those of ignorance and arrogance, you know, there's no need for a person to waste his life being concerned about them being happy or not happy with him, but rather to have the concern towards them. How can he be means of saving them from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So many lessons to be learned from these verses. And as we heard, it's a great lesson for all of us that we should not think that we know ourselves very well. Leave the matter to Allah. Read the Quran and see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about the human beings. This is us. This is myself. This is you. This is everybody. These are our weaknesses. And therefore, we have to work on these weaknesses, otherwise we'll continue to be upon them. Even if people praise us otherwise, or we think otherwise, no, we will have these weaknesses unless we overcome them by efforts, by working, by being patient, by patiently obeying the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fulfilling the orders of Allah. One of the great benefits also to learn that this is how human beings are. So when we see these weaknesses from others, we should understand that's the norm, unless a person work on himself. It shows the virtue of patience and righteous good deeds. It shows that the way of this life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created is in such a way that things doesn't stay on the same way, that things changes. This is how this world is all about. So some people then, and sometimes they have strength and other times they have weaknesses, health, sickness, loss of wealth, gain of wealth, relationships, working sometimes, not working other times. Human beings are not according, they don't do things according to what we desire for them to do. Even our own children, that we think that we raised them and we took care of them, they're not going to be always according to what you like for them to be towards you, right? And things of that nature, so that the person live a comfortable life, live a goodly life, not having expectations that everything is going to be according to something that does not exist. So understanding the reality of this life and knowing that our job is not to have the ultimate enjoyment in this life, because it's not going to happen in that absolute sense. But rather, when you're patient and doing righteous good deeds, you'll have the best and the goodness of this life and in the hereafter. The most important concern for the believer is forgiveness and a great reward. How to attain this? By being patient and doing righteous good deeds. This is general terms, yes. The specifics of it is to follow the deen of Al-Islam, to follow the Quran and the way, the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is how a person would have this goodness in this life and not just following one's desires. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to be also benefiting from this, that it's not for us to change in the religion of Al-Islam. This is the religion of Allah. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed things to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So no one is to change the orders of Allah thinking that this would please others. That doesn't make sense, because what is a person then calling people to? Calling people to his own way, to his own desires, not to the religion of Al-Islam. Yes, a person has to be gradual in teaching others, but not to compromise anything in the deen of Al-Islam and to overlook the ridicule and all of these types of things. And the Prophet, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, you are nothing but a warner and a sincere warner to people, and we should take warnings very seriously and leave the matters to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He is ala kulli shay'in wakil. He's the disposer of all things and all of the affairs of the people. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us benefit from what we heard and to give us steadfastness and strength to our hearts and our physical beings and so on, for us to be steadfast in the deen of Al-Islam till we all return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with forgiveness and a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته
إلا الذين تابوا وأصلحوا وبينوا فأولئك أتوب عليهم وأنا التواب الرحيم
فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون
يا زكريا نبشرك بغلام
يا أيها النبي إنا أرسلناك شاهداً